many have done something which is known as keeping your head down. Well, the time has come when you'd better stick your heads up, and you'd better come over the parapet, and you'd better start fighting, because if you don't start fighting, you won't have a Labour Party any longer that's worthy of the name.
Accountability to the grassroots of this movement. We're talking about greater democracy in this movement. That is the real issue.
It's because I have been responsible now for 5 years to see the policies develop in the subcommittees, come to the executive, go to the unions for consultation, be discussed in the liaison committee with the unions, come to conference, be endorsed. And then I have seen them cast aside in secret by those who are not accountable to this movement.
Three cheers for international socialism.
Two years ago, the Labour Party shook itself to the roots and shook the whole shape of British politics too. It was the most profound change in a major party since the war, certainly, and probably for the last 50 years. Why was there an impulse for change? According to the most effective pressure group, the Campaign for Labour Party Democracy, or CLPD, it really began as far back as 1973, after Harold Wilson's cavalier rejection of Conference's resolution to nationalise the 25 leading private companies. And matters got very much worse over the reselection of Reg Prentice. The final straw was provided for many in the party by his decision to join the Conservative Party. Now, at the first conference after Labour's election defeat in 1979, the stage was set for something of a reckoning. Three major and profound constitutional changes were on the agenda. First, who controls the manifesto? Second, how does the party elect the leader? And third, how accountable should Labour MPs be to their constituencies? Activists propose that each constituency Labour Party, or CLP, should have the right to reselect their MP once in the lifetime of each parliament. Well, mandatory reselection of MPs was indeed passed at that conference. That was the climax of a very prolonged campaign. But some weeks after the conference ended, the resolution was found to have failed on a technicality. And that was just the sort of setback to fuel the determination of CLPD, which is where we take up the story. Our reconstruction of the events behind the events uses actors together with documentary footage. It's based exclusively on interviews with the leading participants.
Incredible. Absolutely incredible. There must have been some midnight oil burned over this one. My God.
It was predictable.
Oh, come on, Vladimir. We win re-selection by a million votes, and then they have the bloody nerve to say it's not valid.
You spotted it, Pete. And I pointed it out. Eric Heffer and others. The amendment produced by Transport House was improperly worded.
He left some wording in which should have gone out, with the result that one section contradicts another.
Wonderful.
As it stood, any MP could have sued the party for carrying out the reselection procedure. It'll have to be put right next conference.
The constituency do the work, the trade union supply the cash, the parliamentary party runs the show, and that's a great arrangement, that is, isn't it?
I just wish our financial side wasn't so desperate. I sit writing begging letters to all and sundry, thinking, what do we do if they all say no?
We just have to keep up the pressure.
No chance of an electric copier, I suppose.
Oh, no. You'll be lucky, mate. I don't suppose there's any chance of a cup of coffee either, is there?
Thanks, please. I'd love one.
I said the wrong thing there, didn't I?
I'm here on a dispute, right?
Oh, come on. I mean, it's not as if I'm asking you anything top secret, am I, for Christ's sake?
I'm here on a manning agreement, OK? I mean, this is for branch. It's for the district committee, isn't it? All this political stuff.
OK, OK. Fair enough. I suppose you have got your hands full on the industrial side. Come on, you're a head office sipping tea with Terry Duffy and Sir John Boyd all day.
How long have you been a branch secretary in this union, Jock? The president, the general secretary. Oh, yeah. I should cocoa.
It's been a very dry day, hasn't it? Why didn't you come in the office? Have a drink.
Twisting me arm, eh?
I hear that Duffy's on the Commission of Inquiry.
That's right.
Uh-huh. And, what line are you taking?
Ah, it's not my department, Jock, the politics.
Ah, yes, but you hear the whispers.
I know what everybody knows. Duffy's backing no change on the constitutional issue. That status quo, right down the line.
Do you agree with that? I mean, is that what the members want?
Well, it's not a matter of personal views, is it? Duffy's been to the National Committee, he's put it to them, he's got a majority. The membership may want to change when Scanlon was president, they don't want it now.
Well, don't talk to me about Scanlon. If he had cast this union's votes the way the members instructed in 1978, reselection would have happened by now.
That old chestnut.
No old chestnut. It was bloody diabolical. I was there, I was the teller. I was doing nut. Telling Huey, cast a vote. Oh no. I'm told to get on with my business, let him get on with his.
Well, if Scanlon made a mistake, it must have been genuine, because he wanted change, same as everybody else. But times have changed, Jock.
Listen, the majority of people on the conference delegation still want constitutional change.
Oh, so you say, Jock, so you say. But the National Committee and the Executive don't want change.
What's this got to do with the National Committee?
Oh, come on, Jock. The National Committee, the lay members, the blokes on the tools are the policy-making body of this union. And they have been consulted on this matter.
Aye, because Duffy knows he's got a right-wing majority sewn up.
There's nothing sewn up in this union, Jock. Everything's in the balance. Elections every 6 months. Every position on every last bloody committee subject to the ballot. Those in power continually bollocking those not in power. And if there's one card-carrying communist on the National Committee, there's a dozen. And as for the bloody crypto-communists, well... Anybody wanted a lesson in the dangers of too much democracy?
Oh, the Labour movement can have too much democracy. Is that what you're saying?
The executive certainly represents the wishes of our members. Now, who gave you buggers a mandate?
What do you mean, us buggers?
This campaign you're mixed up in. All these guys hanging about, come in the Oracle. These intense middle-class burks pestering you outside the bloody bogs.
Oh, come on. Forget about the class prejudice.
It's not a matter of class prejudice. It's the way they keep on butting in, putting their points, and nobody wants to listen.
But there's more want to listen than don't.
They're pulling your strings. Can't you see that? With all this clever stuff.
How many resolutions have we had chucked out on technicalities? We need clever stuff. Oh, no wonder they're bloody squealing, the bureaucrats.
They're a bunch of bloody mischief makers. College boys with their tuppenny halfpenny degrees. These constitutional changes will solve nothing. Thanks for the brew, Jock.
Question of whether we want to take the risk of being branded as Trotskyists.
The press
don't make distinctions, John. On the other hand, it's crazy not to try to unite all the groups who want the same changes in the party that we want, whatever their particular motives.
Will this collaboration include militant, John? Can they spare the time with the revolution just round the corner?
Basically, it's the Labour Coordinating Committee.
Or the Tony Benn Admiration Society.
Found a member, weren't you, Chris?
Well, there's a good deal of cross-membership anyway. Then there's the Socialist Campaign for Labour Victory. I mean, they actually suggested that we all come together. And somewhere along the line, militant tendency might condescend to join us.
The real point here, as Victor says, is that we do need to unite the left in defence of the ground gained at Brighton. The right are starting to get organised. The left have got factions going off in all directions.
Look, you're never going to get militant to do the kind of thing we do. It's too subtle for them. Even our enemies think we're so boring we don't matter. They look at our amendments, our alternative amendments, our amendments to amendments. They don't understand what the hell we're about.
Yeah, and that's the danger. Well, by not understanding or rejecting our tactics, even sympathisers can disrupt our work.
I agree.
Nah, but Militant are far and away the worst. They bang in resolutions for the same constitutional issue, but with impossible demands added. They split our vote by always trying to outflank us on the left.
Not always, Pete. Last year, they put forward a weaker proposal than us, and the mine workers voted for it, which put ours in a very dangerous position.
The fact is that if Militant are involved with us, then the chances of them wrecking our campaign are rather less than if they aren't.
The price we pay is with the media.
OK, if everybody's in favour, we propose to contact the following organisation. The Labour Coordinating Committee, the Socialist Campaign for Labour Victory, the Institute of Workers' Control, Clause 4.
Yes.
Oh. Independent Labour Publications, and the Militant Tendency.
Have we got their address?
And so, with the umbrella rank-and-file mobilising committee formed, one of the greatest historical weaknesses of the left, its capacity for endless amoeba-like splitting, has been headed off. All the left grouplets were united on what they could unite over, that's to say, constitutional reform. On the eve of the 1980 conference, then, the picture looked like this. There would be another fight over mandatory reselection of MPs, but as it had, in effect, already been accepted the previous year, it was hard to see it failing this time. The big issue to emerge was election of the leader. As things stood, the Labour leader, or Prime Minister, was chosen by the Labour MPs, the PLP, that's the Parliamentary Labour Party. The proposal now was that the election should be in the hands of an electoral college, representing MPs, unions, and constituency Labour parties. At conference, the vote would be in two stages. First, they would vote on the principle of widening the vote for the leadership. And then, conference would vote on how that principle should be put into practice. At this stage, all eyes were turned to the unions and how they would cast their block votes. So the scene was set for a momentous conference, vital decisions to be made on two of the great constitutional issues, for power in the party was at stake.
Warm welcome to Blackpool. I also bring you warm fraternal greetings from the Blackpool
of our work this week. And now, let the work begin. Thank you.
For this afternoon's debate on the re-selection of members of Parliament, we shall take the National Executive Committee...
Joe Ashton, Parliamentary Labour Party. Madam Chairman, there's no doubt that whatever happens this week, there is underneath a very great demand in this party for unity. Everybody accepts that, that the arguments have got to come to an end, and this is the week they've got to end. But ask yourselves, if we have this question of mandatory re-selection, what sort of unity there's going to be in many constituencies? Ask yourself who outside the Labour Party wants mandatory reselection. Have you seen the Tory press attacking the idea of mandatory reselection? There's been a few comments in editorials. The media cannot wait for mandatory reselection because they'll have Prentice sagas right through the country, right up to the next election. And Mrs. Thatcher would vote for mandatory reselection. Make no mistake about that. Mrs. Thatcher will vote for mandatory re-selection. And I'll tell you this, and I'll tell my friend Tony Benn, when you were sacked, Tony, from your seat by the House of Lords in a very unfair way, you fought and fought again to get that seat back, and you've never stopped fighting the House of Lords since. And MPs who think they've been unfairly sacked will tend to react in the same way. It's as simple as that. And don't forget this, that will happen. Not at the next election, it'll happen before then. If Roy Jenkins wanted to form a party of 25 sacked MPs now, in this Parliament, they could be in business in 6 months. And they'd be backed by the media, they'd get all the publicity, they'd get all the cash. It would be the biggest push to the three-party system delivered by this conference that the political scene had ever seen.
I now have the result of the card vote. Speedy work, speedy work. For the motion, 3,798,000. Against the motion, 3,341,000. I declare the motion carried, and accordingly, Resolution 17 falls.
Chris, I'm sick. Do you know that? Sick. Sitting in there with Duffy and Boyd and this bloody mandate we've got in the leadership.
It's a status quo, is it, Jock?
Yeah.
You know Jock, do you? AOEW.
Oh, I think. The National Committee sent us here with a firm mandate. No change. 35 people in the delegation, and I'm bloody certain that a majority of those people are on our side. But the National Committee's the boss.
Still, reselection's gone through.
Yeah, but it was close. Closer than last time.
We knew it'd be close because of your lot. The leadership will be absolutely knife edge.
We've talked to our friends on the NEC. We've suggested to them, let's have a first resolution that simply asks that the present procedure for the election of a leader should be changed.
They agree the conference should vote on the principle first.
In other words, if it's carried, then we get a clear statement from conference that it does support change.
See, if we simply debate alternative methods, no particular one gets through, then the whole idea falls.
We are going to have a debate on 2A, which deals only with the principle that there should be a widening of the franchise. That's all you're voting on. And until we know whether that is carried or lost, we can't go ahead with alternative propositions, and the debate must be limited to the principle.
We see it like this. If the principle's changed, then a union like yours, which is mandated to oppose the principle, has to think again, doesn't it?
See, once the principle's agreed, it's a new situation. It could be open to interpretation by Duffy. Could be up to the delegation.
Oh, yes, no question.
So if your delegation, for instance, is balanced 18 to 17, with the left wing having a majority of one...
Then Mr. Duffy and Sir John could find themselves outmaneuvered.
Agreed.
Gavin Strang, Labour Member of Parliament for East Edinburgh. I support the proposition that we extend the franchise because I believe that we should elect our leader by an electoral college consisting of Labour MPs, constituency party delegates and trade union delegates. And let us dismiss right away the suggestion that an electoral college is impractical. If the Labour Party wants to elect its leader by an electoral college, then the Labour Party is able to do so. Let us also dismiss the argument that because there's a difference of view about the composition of the college, that we shouldn't have one. Let's settle that later. It's a bit like saying that we shouldn't have nationalised the steel industry because there was different views about the representation of workers on the board. No, we can have an electoral college and we can subsequently agree on its composition. And I say this to the trade union delegations. Many of you are sitting beside presidents and general secretaries whom you've elected at one stage or other. Indeed, the engineers are electing their president at the moment. And I understand the miners will soon be electing a president. How can you defend a situation where you are going to vote to prevent Labour Party members from having any say whatsoever in the election of their leader when you elect your leader?
Most of our social democratic and socialist comrades in all the European parties in and out of the common market have a wider franchise than us. So it isn't a terribly revolutionary proposal. It's a very moderate one. And I lastly say to our colleagues in the trade unions, the point was very well made by Gavin. If we believe in democracy, we believe in the widest involvement in every section of our movement. So why shouldn't the rank and file trade unionists through their organisations, have some say in who the leader of the party is. And I'll say to those trade unionists who are thinking of voting the other way, just take note of what Gavin said. It was a very important point. So without any further, I ask this conference to support the principle of widening the franchise. If we agree with that, we can then argue as to the best way we can do it in a few minutes' time.
Thank you very much. Now, I'm going to read the resolution which is before conference, which is 2A. Conference is voting on this resolution in principle that the procedure for the election of the leader and deputy leader of the party should be changed to allow for a widening of the franchise for election. Full stop. Those in favour? Those against? Card vote. Quiet, please. I now have the result of the last card vote. For the resolution, 3,609,000. Against, 3,511,000.
The mandate's lost. Conference does want change. Now, there are two different motions to vote on, and Duffy cannot vote independently for either of them because he does not have a mandate to do that.
That is absolute rubbish, Jock.
What do you mean, independently? Duffy has been instructed by the National Committee. Not requested, instructed.
Yes, to vote against change. He has no mandate to vote on the new motion. I say he must call a full-scale meeting of all our delegates right now.
The National Committee is the voice of the union speaking for the majority of the membership. You are in the minority, John.
Every other trade union leader is consulting his delegation.
Only those trade unions that haven't got a clear mandate. And we have, as you bloody well know, against change.
Well, for connoisseurs of the Labour Party, this was vintage stuff. Conference had voted in principle for change, but then later that afternoon threw out the proposals offered for introducing that change. And for good measure, many union delegates, such as the engineers, had the dilemma of deciding how to cast a vote when the circumstances foreseen had totally altered. Now, the party's national executive, the NEC, suggested that the issue of the shape of the electoral college for choosing the leader shouldn't be allowed to hang loose. They suggested introducing new proposals immediately to avoid further delay, and that soon ran into trouble, as you'll see. And the day's events had one further consequence besides. There'd been an all-too-obvious row in the engineers' delegation on the floor of the conference, with Jock Quinn in the forefront, on how to vote. And that followed what was taken as an attack on the engineers' executive by Jock from the rostrum itself the day before. The dispute over those events was to crop up later. But let's rejoin the story where the CLPD, like everyone else, are taking stock of the fact that confusion reigns, with the principle of change in the election of leader accepted, but the methods put forward for implementing that change rejected.
How the hell did we lose both the options?
Thank God we got the principle taken first.
It's the end. The bloody beginning of the end. This sodding principle. You can't have the party machine instructing the parliamentary party. It's government by diktat.
The trouble with you, mate, is you can't take democracy. You want it settled over brandy and cigars.
Don't tell me you buggers aren't fixing things. Don't tell me there aren't some very smart operators. Some very nifty footwork.
Oh, well, we tried.
There was a time at these conferences that you'd never get two resolutions the same. Never see all these duplicated things, things coming from every constituency, from Land's End to John O'Groats. Identical wording. Bloody pressure job, isn't it?
It's called persuasion.
The party is crossing a line. Fundamental principles are being smashed down.
The principles this party stands for went out with Keir Hardie. Maybe now we'll get some of them back.
Callaghan sold us down the river at that bloody commission. Healy should have stood up and said these are fundamental issues. The whole concept by which the Labour Party operates has been totally changed by bloody Bolsheviks. It's not on.
The NEC meets again tomorrow morning at
8. They've instructed their officers to draw up new proposals.
Listen, I've talked to Tony Benn. The left-wing members of the NEC are meeting later tonight. I've arranged for you and Vladimir to see Tony just before that.
We need to compromise, Vladimir. Just a bit. We must find an acceptable formula and urge Tony to support it.
Obviously something in between 50% for the unions and thirds.
The essential element of whatever's agreed is that it must include recorded voting.
You really ought to be at that meeting tonight, Vladimir. They can be incredibly thick about these things.
Are you telling us the left wing of the NEC wants 40% for the MPs? Joking. How did that happen?
We couldn't persuade them. They feel 40 to the unions doesn't stand a chance. I'm tired. I'm going to bed.
Oh, it's a massive lobbying job, isn't it? If Tony Benn and our other members on the NEC are reconvening at 8 in the morning, then there's still time to make them see sense. It's got to be 40 to the unions.
From the BBC Radio Newsroom, this is Peter Donaldson with the news at midnight. It's been a day of setbacks for Labour's right wing at the party conference in Blackpool. The left won two important votes. The party leader will not in future be elected only by MP.
So there's this chap selling newspapers, right? He's always out front. So I said to him, did he know Dennis Skinner? And he didn't know Dennis Skinner from Eric Heffernan. So I said, well, had he seen any bloke walking in?
Thank God I got Frank alone. So, the NEC are meeting right now. And our people are pushing for 40% for the unions.
Something is going on. There's a meeting at the Winter Gardens at 11:30. Probably the baronial hall, which seems rather appropriate. Most of the big union chiefs will be there. Basnett, Jackson, Jenkins, Fisher. I hear a rumour that Basnett and Jackson are up to something.
Tom Jackson, Union of Communication Workers. I come to oppose the NEC proposal. And I do so because I have had no opportunity whatsoever to consult with the people who sent me here about changes which are being proposed time after time. The NEC are producing constitutional changes with the speed of a conjurer producing white rabbits from a top hat. And that is not the way our party should do business.
This is a fundamental change, but it's a fundamental change if we're to make. We should make by considering different views. Why should only the executive be able on this fundamental issue to be the only body putting a motion before this conference? Let us all, let the union, let the constituency parties, let us have unity, let us have democracy, let's go home and think about it and come back in January.
Ready?
Yep.
Home, James.
Shadow Cabinet's pulled a fast one. It's a disgrace.
Oh, let's not kid ourselves, Chris. They're boxing clever now. It's all been timed to the last minute. I mean, it's ridiculous. Michael Foot's deputy leader, he should be made caretaker until after Wembley. We don't need an election now.
I know. But, John, if it is going to happen, then Michael Foot's got to stand.
But what about Tony Benn?
He's been talked out of it. Foot is the only candidate who can defeat Dennis Healey. And Healey must be defeated. Otherwise, we're back to square one.
It makes you sick, doesn't it? I mean, in 3 months' time, Wembley could change this bloody feudal system of picking the leader for good. And here they are, the last knockings. Still trying to slip one in.
Oh, come on now, John. You can't sit in your private committees, committees that effectively preempt rank-and-file meetings, and then bowl in here and say, well, we in the CLPD think the proportion should be 38% to the unions, prospective parliamentary candidates should be included, and the LCC and its thirds can go jump in the lake.
Any tactical plans that I put to this committee come from the campaign, not myself personally. Now, within the campaign, we've had a hell of a barney over this and have come to a collective decision.
Yeah, yeah.
And the campaign, may I remind you, is an organisation that for years has battled away on these issues, while you lot have sat on your behinds theorising about socialist utopias and getting bloody nowhere. Well, I think a bit of humility would be in order, quite honestly.
Humility? We've been at this full time. You were driving a bloody van until a few months ago.
Oh. I think when it's a question of tactics, you haven't got much of a contribution to make. Bloody clowns. All this crap about backing thirds, making out there's some high principle involved. It's just a matter of choosing the most winnable formula, and that's not bloody thirds that was tossed out at Blackpool.
No point in losing your temper.
But I thought all this had been thrashed out. I mean, even Militant, for Christ's sake, agree on this one.
Main concern is, we all agree to campaign for the same option.
Yeah, but it must be an option that's winnable.
Hmm. All right, well, you think 38's winnable. I don't altogether agree. I think thirds will get a good deal of union support. I think that's obviously the
case. Chris, 38 gives more say to the unions, which is what they want. But it's not as drastic as 50, it's not as diluted as thirds. Now, it's the sort of figure that a middle-of-the-road trade union might go for.
Yes, all right. But if you want them to agree to our position, then you've got to be a bit diplomatic. Otherwise, we'll have splinter groups going for everything under the sun.
Well, it seems we'll have to take a decision.
I don't see why we can't reconvene the annual delegates. No.
Listen, all right, we've had a certain number of branches seeking a special delegates meeting, but it's not exactly a mass demand.
It's perfectly proper for the executive to formulate a proposition on this.
But the point I'm making is that when the delegates met last April, they mandated us to support status quo at the Blackpool Conference. No constitutional changes, that was our mandate.
We voted according to that. We exercised our vote and we lost. The majority decision, which we have to accept, was that change should take place.
The feeling is we should be part of that change.
Look, there is an obvious groundswell for change. Now, do we want to be part of that debate, or do we want to sit here like dummies? I mean, this union has got 429,000 votes. That is the fifth largest block vote at conference. We have got the political muscle. We should use it.
My argument is quite simple. We've got 40% for the unions on the table. We've had 50 for the MPs.
Didn't somebody mention thirds?
Oh, thirds is neither one thing nor the other. It looks like a compromise. It looks weak.
I hear transport and generals going for thirds. Do you call them weak?
In terms of political policy, yes, I do.
Coming back to the agenda. I get the impression that 40's top run around this table. Now, I'd say this. All right. Status quo was voted down at Blackpool. But the spirit of status quo is that the decisive voice in the election of the party leader should go to his fellow members of Parliament.
Well, that's my view exactly.
In that case, I move the convening of a special delegates conference to decide this issue.
It's out of the question, because the rules don't permit it.
Well, with the greatest respect, we've had one man, one vote, which the so-called gang of three are running. We've had 90% for the MPs. Nobody around this table wants to know. We've had abstention suggested.
Abstention's gone.
Yes, all right,
almighty.
All right. You may groan on that, but I think the delegates would take a different attitude.
Listen, a union with our voting strength should have an amendment down. If all these constituencies and campaigns and whatnot have got amendments down from here to bloody Wigan,
well, could we have some discussion on one man, one vote?
One man, one vote, as far as the Labour Party is concerned, would be a shambles. And as far as administration's concerned, the Labour Party's already enough of a shambles.
And that's an ex-MP talking. National executive man into the bargain.
Trying to say we couldn't send a few voting forms out.
You lose people's addresses. They go with it, and there are hundreds of people that never get voting papers.
And apart from all that, it means that the unions don't have a vote. That could mean pressure from the press on individual members. There could even be a danger of infiltration.
Could we keep to the proposition, which is 40%? As I see it, this union has traditionally operated at left of centre.
Don't let our members down at Harrods and Fortnum and Mason's know that, will you? Because the majority of people would see us as right of centre.
All right, come on now. We'll have a proposition.
Look, change is inevitable. Now, as I see it, the Labour Party is the trade union movement. So our support should go for a majority trade union weighting. It's only right and proper we should have some measure of control.
And over and above that, there's the question of funding.
Right.
It's an open secret that the financial state of the Labour Party is, to say the least, shocking. We're being asked time and time again to dip our hands in our pockets, and there's no one dips their hands deeper than this.
Right.
Now, if we're being constantly called upon to cough up the cash, I feel the need for us to have some control over the people who are spending is the paramount consideration in this matter.
Absolutely.
Well, we've got the proposition, which is a weighting of 40% for the unions. Shall we take a vote on that, Sid?
All those in favour?
...259 proposals for an electoral college of conference, 17 for a college separate from conference, 10 for a college conducted by letter...
Only the post office union, I expect.
10 for various bits and bobs, and 75 for the one man, one vote.
You must have a chance, sir, with Shirley and David using their sex appeal, plus all the press backing.
By my calculations...
Steal them on your tablecloth, Vladimir.
Thirds has got a potential 2 million votes going for it. Mm. 50 for MPs, if you include the engineers who are actually proposing 75, has got 3 million.
I see Usdaw's chosen 40% to the unions.
Usdaw?
What are the shop workers?
You're joking.
Well, they voted status quo at Blackpool, I know that.
Amendment 76, here it is. I think we should withdraw ours.
What? And get behind us, Dor, after all the rows we've had in the committee? I mean, first we cut down the union share from 50 to 38, then we dropped the prospective parliamentary candidates idea, and now you're saying we should drop our proposals altogether.
But why should us, Dor, go for 40? It's incredible.
Well, they have got a new General Secretary, Bill Watley.
Yeah, but he's nothing, if not moderate, insofar as he is political at all.
One thing seems clear. Here we have a middle-of-the-road union with an affiliation, if my memory serves me right, of over 400,000.
429.
Deduct 429,000 from the total against us. Add them to our voting figures, and we could have a majority.
They'll never move this. Somebody will get on the telephone to Bill Watley and say, oh, come on now, Bill, what is all this nonsense?
I object very strongly to the idea that unions aren't democratic.
I'm sorry, Victor.
The structure is always there, it's just that sometimes it's worked badly.
That's right.
The engineers could be crucial.
Oh, you're kidding. There's no way their 75% for MPs is going to get anywhere.
Yes, John. But what'll they do when it does fall?
Don't believe me? Go and take a look at yourself. I make a bet and I'll bet in there. You're banging. Standing up, banging up bloody table, shouting about how democratic the union is.
Like I said, you're on your own.
Still running me down, is he, our president?
Scrub it, Jock.
It's all right. I know what he calls me. That bloody communist.
You know what he means?
Oh, yeah. He means I am the president, this is the executive council, and if nine of us say that you are guilty, then that's it.
We don't want a Barney, Jock.
only get one, because this penalty is right out of order. I am going to the lawyers about it.
Come on, Jock. Your behaviour at Blackpool was bloody disgraceful.
You've drummed up these charges, bringing disrepute on the union. Oh, aye, you've all sat in there in front of the oak panelling and so forth, very high and mighty. Brother Quinn, we hereby instruct you that your credentials are withdrawn for 12 months, and you're drummed off the Wembley delegation by order.
You can appeal?
Oh, yes, next October. And I'm going to do a lot more than appeal. I've told you. I'm going to the lawyers.
Who picks the bill up, Jock?
Maybe I'll give up my holidays.
Oh, you take my advice. Forget lawyers. Keep this internal. I mean, be fair. You can't go to a conference and start abusing the president and the general secretary of your own union in front of 2 million viewers and get away with it.
There was no abuse. I merely took a firm attitude and I reminded them of their obligations.
No abuse? You went to the media and dragged the name of this union to disrepute.
I have got witnesses.
Oh, you got obligations too, Jock. All right, so you think the destiny of the Labour Party is up for grabs, and you want to be a part of the drama. So go on, drag the unions to the courts. But don't be surprised if a lot of people get bloody angry about it.
Oh, we've got things about right now, haven't we? When the Wembley delegation with me out of the reckoning.
Oh, that's bloody ridiculous, Jock, and you know it, if that was the position. If there was the sort of balance on that delegation that you imagine, Jock, we'd have deferred this case. We couldn't have lived with that.
You do your sums different than me.
Aye, well, it's not a question of arithmetic, is it? We got a clear mandate from the National Committee with no room for deviation, an absolute majority for MPs over all other sections.
And when that falls?
If that falls, we abstain.
You're joking. You're telling me you're going to take an entire delegation, all on expenses, and just sit in your hands?
The policy-making body of this union has given us firm instructions, I'll be honest. After all the mudslinging that has caused so much damage to this union's public image, we sought such instruction from our members. Nothing less than 51%, that's our position. We asked for the letter of the law, we got it. We will abide by it. And to do anything less than that will be betrayal.
We've been doing our sums, see. In effect, stop supporting our resolution. Look, don't argue, just do what I'm telling you. I've had to say this 79 times already. I'll say it to you just once more. Make sure you get behind Usdaw's resolution. Well, they'll just have to have another meeting then, won't they?
We dropped our resolution in favour of Usdaw's 40-30-30 for the union. And we're asking everyone who supported us to do the same.
They met at the Charing Cross Hotel. I mean, there's no doubt that the right wing are trying to get organised at the 11th hour. There's meetings, frantic phone calls. Oh, even left-wing trade union leaders are being telephoned. Oh, excuse me. Jock, well done. Well done, you're back on the delegation.
Yes, indeed, I've got an injunction, so I get my credentials back tonight. Well, I bloody best I'll get them back.
We'll be in constant communication and try as best we can to guide you through the maze that the Arrangements Committee have created. Okay.
The object is to keep the Usdaw amendment going. Keep that as your basic aim. Whatever happens, Usdaw must be given no opportunity to withdraw. They must be locked in.
Look, what I'd like some of you to do when you're back in your groups and they're whittling down these amendments is to look for their general secretary. He's a bloke called Bill Watley, a Geordie. He'll have the Usdaw badge. Now, look, if you find this fella, I want you to go up to him, shake him by the hand, tell him what a bloody good bloke he is, say that you're right behind his amendment all the way and that you'd be proud to have him present your constituency's case for it before conference, all right?
Yeah, good. Yeah.
Well, not a bad meeting, George.
Good night. Take care.
You do see, Bill, the danger the party's in. How important it is we don't get the wrong result tomorrow.
Look, it's not in my hands, is it? I've had people making the point all bloody day. It's not in my hands.
All I'm saying, Bill, is that you're now the front runner with the left's option. Are you happy with that?
I don't see it from that angle.
Well, you'd better start. Here we are, a moderate union. Here's you two, moderates, with a proposal that's giving the left wing what it wants.
It was the executive's choice, Charlie. Bill's on a bound to let it run, see it debated. Chances are it'll be eliminated, then we fall back to our position of 50 for the MPs.
We argued for 40, we got 40. We had left-wing delegates pushing thirds. We overcame it. What more can we do?
You can go to the Arrangements Committee and withdraw. Support 50s from the start.
Look, I've had all this at the group meeting. Pressure from all sides. People coming up. UKAT's doing this. ESTMS is doing that. I resisted. Because I also had a lot of people backing our amendment.
You've got ASTMS, Charlie. You've got Clive Jenkins with a 40 proposal. The votes will get behind him, ours will fall, then we switch to 50.
The word is Clive Jenkins' delegation have instructed him to withdraw.
The media don't see it your way, Charlie. They think he's wheeling and dealing.
They see it as a straight fight between thirds and 50 for the MPs. Transport and general on one hand, general and municipal and engineers on the other.
Big lads, with real clout.
People have withdrawn in our favour, Charlie. A lot of people. We owe it to them to see the thing is debated.
We had a full discussion at executive level. The hands went up, the 40 got it. I've stuck with that through standing orders. I'm taking it to the rostrum. I'm not exposing this union to ridicule by backing out now.
Bill, how do you see it personally?
I think 50's going to walk it. Because even if we do get locked in and it's a final issue between 40 or 50, I cannot see the engineers abstaining at the death.
You're being naive, Bill. Why take the risk of getting locked in on something you don't personally want?
I'm not here to act personally. I'm here to act as General Secretary with an executive instruction. And that's what I'm going to do.
Throughout the day, big unions have been making their final decisions about how to cast those big block votes tomorrow. They may not have a decisive say in the choice of Labour leader once the Electoral College has agreed, but they will certainly have a decisive say in the shape of that electoral college. So it's the marshalling of those block votes that is our main interest tonight. John Tews has been down at Westminster all evening doing his sums.
Well, in mid-afternoon, there were two major areas of uncertainty remaining. One surrounded the voting intentions of Usdaw, that's the shop workers' union, with 430,000 votes. Now, they had their own constitutional proposal, 40% of the unions, 30% of the others. But if that was defeated, there's no certainty, on the left at least, that Usdaw would then fall in with the one-third, one-third, one-third proposal. And of course, Usdaw's votes are needed by the left to ensure victory. Well, this evening, Usdaw was still making up their minds, but it's clear that the left are going all out to make sure that in the end, Usdaw were on their side of the vote. Now, the other area of uncertainty involves the engineers. We know what they're for, the idiosyncratic proposal for 75% of the votes to go to MPs. But what are they against? Vincent Hanna spent most of the evening trying to find out what the engineers will do.
And with the row in the High Court today about one left-wing member of that delegation, there's been a lot of strong feeling and long argument here. But when Terry Duffy, the union president, arrived tonight, he made it abundantly clear that, pressure or not, he wasn't changing his mind.
We're attempting to obtain the right to vote against any amendment. And if we have that opportunity, we'll be voting against any motion that doesn't give the majority to the PLP.
I'm now going to withdraw in favour of Usdaw.
Please support Usdaw's resolution 76. And I'm asking and telling that we are in fact
resolution 76. Under the name of Usdaw, and let's move.
To have your attention, I'll announce the result of the third ballot. There was a total vote of 6,240,000 votes, and they were cast in the following way. Option 4, 3,375,000. Option 6, 2,800,000.
And so the final twist took place. Against all the odds, the Usdaw motion won. The vote giving the unions the greatest share in the election of the Labour Party leader came about as a result of a proposal from a right-wing union. The left spotted that possibility and then by superior tactics locked the motion in. The left won all they wanted by supporting a right-wing motion. That was one irony. There was another. In a sense, the right defeated itself. For the engineers, those pillars of the right-wing Labour establishment, also locked themselves into a self-defeating position. With their proposal for a 75% share in the college for MPs predictably defeated, they abstained, as they were instructed to do. And at a stroke, a million right-wing votes were removed from the battlefield. Now, the consequences of the left's superior tactics were profound. A shift of power inside the party, away from MPs and to the constituency activists and the unions. And that trend still has to run its course. The other immediate effect was more overtly dramatic, the breakaway of leading Labour MPs to form the Social Democratic Party, creating a new pattern in British politics. For the day after the Wembley conference, the Council for Social Democracy was born.